come up the show this week, we have our good friend Paul MacDonald, who we refer to as Donny constantly throughout, in case you're wondering who we're talking about. This week, we talk about the lockdown, Motherwell, what the fuck is happening at Celtic FC, best sports
Celtic FC.
I've never heard them been called that by a Scottish person before, man.
Best sports star stroke team ever, Tiger Woods, Muhammad Ali, mixed gender sports, AI in sport, doping, VAR, the offside rule, referees, Mo Farah, Arcadia Group, online shopping versus shopping centres, Ronnie O'Sullivan, restrictions and mental health ramifications, Roger Federer, Zlatan Ibrahimovic, Diego Maradona and the Hand of God, institutional racism and colonization, LIDAR and BBC Storyville. So let's go.
Welcome to episode 20 of the Carbon Copy COVID Curer podcast. There will be some bad language, probably. We're on Spotify and Apple, Anchor and YouTube. Give us a follow and a subscribe. We're a wedding band on lockdown doing a podcast. My name's Martin. I play guitar in the band. I'm joined by our lead singer, David Swan.
How's it going?
Our bass player, Mark Caulfield.
Hello there.
And our drummer, Neil McDougall.
Evening.
We're lucky enough to have a special guest tonight, a football journalist, co-founder of footballcritic.com, SportsFanMedia and former chief at goal.com. He's been published on BBC Sport, Sporting Life, BT Sport and many more. Fellow Motherweller and friend of the band, Paul MacDonald. Welcome, Donny.
Hey guys.
All right, mate.
Paul.
Welcome along.
Thanks for having me.
How are you getting on?
Welcome.
Chong for a scoop, mate, to be honest. Just drinking the house doesn't cut the mustard after a while, do you know what I mean? Just that wee ability to get out and nip out for a pint and then come back is a lost art these days, man. I miss it.
How's things doing? Are you still doing in Leeds, aye?
Aye, mate. So we're going to get into tier three as of Thursday. But this is how stupid it is. It's the missus's birthday on Friday. I probably shouldn't be putting this on recording in case I get done for it, but we're just going to jump my train to York. York's about 6 miles to the east, and they're tier two, and all the pubs and restaurants are open there, so we're just going to go on the train and go up to York for the day, then come back. Which kind of tells you how stupid it is that when they're putting the tiers in place, that you can be that close, and then...
Like, ridiculous.
You can go to Harrogate. So Harrogate's just in just north of there, about 6-7 miles, a lovely place, loads of eating places and that, and then York to the east. Guarantee that next weekend those two places will be absolute carnage with everybody in West Yorkshire piling in so they can do all their shopping and get a nice wee bite to eat and a pint while they're doing it. So just stupid. Stupid at this stage.
Did that read right that Rita Ora get fined 10 grand for having a birthday party?
She did, aye.
Did she? Fuck me. Fucking hell. She can afford that, mind you, but that's some fine, innit?
It gets to the point where there's a wee local guy down for me who's opened up a kind of craft beer place. And I always try to give him a bit of business in that. Not because I like a pint or anything, just want to help out the local trade and that, do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But he's humped because he literally put the deposit down on a second place in February. And he's nobody able to open it yet. So it's still sitting there all done up and all that, and it's been sitting shut for 7 months.
Nice.
So, man. We're punishing these local businesses and are just putting it right into the hands of fucking cunts like Witherspoons and all that who can buy up all the space.
I know. And I see the thing is as well, I'm going to sound like a fucking Facebook moaner here, right, but I was doing Wishy the other day and the whole industrial part was all open and all that, you know, your Matalans and your B&Ms and all these big stores and all the wee shops up the high street were all shut. I'm like, what's the difference between them and them? I don't get that. So it seems to be targeted at small businesses that are really suffering now. It's fucking terrible, man.
That's always how it goes, though. It's always the smaller people that don't have the facilities to to compete. And if there is, it's these arbitrary rules about what you need to sell in a shop, which, you know, somebody that's like a small business that sells a specific thing, maybe don't sell like garden furniture or whatever criteria you need to meet. And it's a shame because you get places like Tesco and B&Q and Marks and Spencer's, you know, just doing what they've done the whole time, monopolising the whole market.
That's the thing, right? So, like, see, during the first lockdown, when everybody was kind of in it together and all that, and you had to queue outside the supermarkets and all that, none of that shit happens now.
I know.
So folk just walk about in there and they hang all the tap at you.
I know.
They're just absolute breeding grounds for fucking disease. That's what they are. But there's no queues outside any supermarkets, there's no proper social distancing.
No.
And I read the other day that 41% of the cases that are getting picked up are in supermarkets.
Is that right? Aye.
21, fucking hell.
It must be the same with schools as well. I mean, the schools never get mentioned in any of the sort of criticism of the stuff. It's always like students and just people partying, whatever. But it's never, nobody ever thinks schools, you know, loads of kids in a tight environment, supermarkets, what you say. I mean, it just seems so bizarre that they get away with, you know, just repeating this narrative and people seem to swallow it up. You know, it's always this thing, people better behave themselves in that.
I know, mate,
it's
that's
people,
it.
But people, that's the cause, that people aren't behaving, that's how Christmas is getting ruined. Behave yourself for Christmas, it's
aye.
Just a lot of shit.
But it's like, we've reached a stage now where the government clearly doesn't think that people can be responsible.
I mean, well, 60,000 people have died and there isn't nobody bats an eyelid, you know what I mean?
Aye.
No, I find funny now as well, I was watching that fucking Cock Hank, or whatever his name is, the day Hancock coming out, and he was saying, "We've got this virus back under control," as if it was a victory. And I'm like, the mere fact that you're saying back under control fucking means that you lost control of it, you spoon. Know what I mean? Yeah, it's just ridiculous. See all this stiff upper lip shit. And see when Boris said, "Need to be jolly careful," I nearly fucking spewed my dinner over the flare, man. and kicked my dogs about the whole house, man, because I was like, I cannot fucking stand any more of this, man. It's literally like living in spitting image. It's literally like that. No, man, it's a fucking joke.
Probably should have never opened the place back up, really, I guess.
Yeah.
If they all knew the second wave was coming and all that, but
they should never have opened anything up knowing that there's still a chance that people are going to contract the disease and die when it isn't under control. The only places that have done it well that are opening up are places that have got zero cases. Like Melbourne, I've seen recently, they've got zero cases, so they've been shut properly, can't fly anywhere or that. They've just opened it up at that point, whereas we're like, just again, as I've said before, probably in this, the typical sort of people will die, can't save every job. Sort of right-wing mentality is we'll look after most of the people, but a few just need to go, and that we can't do anything about that. I just feel like there needs to be a wee bit of let's try and save everybody, you know, let's always try, and let's try and save every job. Always try it, do you know what I mean? Because you're fucked either way, financially, as a country, you know, you're gonna take a hit no matter what happens, so always try and go the full distance, you know, save everybody.
But see, we play devil's advocate in that, Merv, like, that's Philip Green's fucking Arcadia up, going under the day, 13,000 mm-hmm. jobs, right? How many of they folk are going to be fucking clinically depressed or Christmas? Or how many suicides?
No.
How many lives are going to be lost as a result? Do you know what I mean? Sometimes the cure can be worse than the disease. And
aye, so they need to be paid. That's the other thing. That's what we need to go hand in hand. You need to just say, right, this is going to cost a fortune, just pay everybody, you know, whatever it takes, just pay them, try and save the 13,000 jobs for next whatever it is, you know, just try. But there just isn't any will to try. It's just, and the thing is, it's like, it's back to this sort of behave yourself. It's like, to me, it's just one of the same thing. You behave yourself, or we can't save everybody, or, you know, what do you expect us? You expect us to save everybody? Like, we'll fucking try and save somebody. Try and either save the jobs or save the people, but don't lose the jobs and the people. I mean, it's the worst record, must be one of the worst economy record and the worst death rate. So, what what have they actually done in any way?
Achieved nothing.
You know?
They've had literally achieved nothing. They've got it wrong at every conceivable stage. Like, whatever way you wanted to do it, they've done, as Merv just said, they've done the worst of both worlds here. And it's just, see, the overriding problem with that is, I don't want to get into too much politics debate, right, but obviously we're from Motherwell, right, and I'm a lifelong fucking lefty Labour supporter, right. See, with the Tories were coming through in the 80s and 90s, right, I fucking hated them, but I at least knew they were competent at hating us. Like, see, like Thatcher and fucking Heseltine and all his, mm-hmm. all the cronies, right, you at least knew these people had an agenda. They were intelligent in putting forward that agenda, mm-hmm. because they were good at what they did, right? See, these fucking idiots, they don't have any agenda other than making sure they get their fucking expenses at the end of the month, and that's the worrying thing. Like, mm-hmm. politics has descended into this argument where anybody with half a brain just goes into the private sector now, because why the fuck would you want the hassle of running about with these morons?
No, no. And even guys like Heseltine and that, and I seen David Cameron the other day, and I'm no fan of these people, I'm the same as you, Donny, you know, always been against this, but you know, guys like David Cameron, when the Tories announced they were going to cut the aid budget as part of their savings, he's like, that's one of the worst things that's ever happened. Even him, even a Tory that we all used to love and hate and thought that was the epitome of a Tory, is actually, when you compare it to what we've got now, this is a whole different breed.
Aye, that's it. It's like a lobster in the pan, do you know what I mean? Like, it doesn't, like, you don't really realise how bad it is until the country's on fire, and that's kind of what's happened in the last 12 months. You've had the worst possible circumstances of Brexit and pandemic with the worst set of cunts you could possibly put together.
Fuck.
That's it. Shall we, let's just wrap it up.
That's it.
Thanks for coming on, Donny. Banco, what is that tune from?
Grandstand. Grandstand, yes, I realise it says Question the Sport on the sheet, but that tune, I don't like questions, but that, I had to pay tribute to one of the greatest fucking TV theme tunes ever. Grandstand is a fucking masterpiece. The midsection is fucking class as well.
Nero as good as a snooker tune.
Fucking what a tune that is, man.
I like the, what's the cricket one?
Ah, it's a belter as well, man.
Yeah. So, since you came on tonight, Donny, we thought we'd do a wee sort of sport thing.
Absolutely.
For the podcast, so we've got a couple of questions that we can really think about, so...
I'll go first. What the fuck's wrong with Celtic, Donny? What the fuck has happened to Celtic, mate?
I knew that was coming.
What kind of sports science can you tell me to get this back in the fucking road here, man? I've never seen a collapse like this in my life.
First of all, mate, you want to come and watch fucking Mull for the past 30 years? you've not won a trophy in 29 years, you've only won 11 and 4, and you're out fucking kicking down fences at the stadium.
I know, what about the ball bags last night, man?
Fucking talk about privilege, man. Come on, what the fuck?
Ridiculous, mate. And I was posting in some of the chats when I was hearing them all. I think, I mean, to put it, to play devil's advocate, to use your words, I mean, see, if they weren't 11 points behind in the league and out of the Champions League, that yesterday wouldn't have been, I think yesterday was a breaking point. You know, when most people would have went away going, right, they've won 36 cup games in a row, they've won 3 fucking trebles, they're going for a 4th treble, this will never be done again, they lost a cup game, fair play, but I think it's because it's been, you know, in with everything else. No justifying it, by the way, what they've done getting there, they're fucking clowns, man.
Well,
and
here's a
never
couple,
seen Celtic, you know, half of them.
I know, mate. Well, here's a couple of anecdotes that will make you even more worried, right? So,
oh, great. Cheers, mate.
Depressing Monday. We should be doing this on a Friday night rather than a fucking Monday. Is that not the day of the week of the fucking tops myself? But
Monday, aye.
So, first one is, I know a guy used to drink the tavern quite a bit. He doesn't live around here anymore, but he's quite good pals, me and my brother, and he's got a marketing degree, and he ended up in it. That's about 5 years ago. He got his absolute dream job in at Celtic, dealing with the Celtic's marketing team, and he quit after 6 months because the entire organisation of the marketing team was about 70 years behind, man, in terms of where fit was now. He's like, I couldn't have wished for a better job, but once I got in there, it was a nightmare because, like, what people were like, oh, if they go to the internet and computers and that, like, almost like a kind of level of stupid, like, fucking completely backwardsness. And then the second one is, I've got a wee bit of money invested in a company, an AI company that can predict injuries before they happen. And they've been working with some big teams across the world, and they're in at Rangers right now, and Rangers haven't had an injury in about 7 weeks. Celtic doesn't have anything like this in place at the moment, just because there's no comprehension of the advancements of that side of the business, whereas for what I'm hearing inside Ibrox, they're taking it extremely seriously to try and get that edge back, and it's working. It's working. Whereas Peter Lawwell's answer is, go and get Neil Lennon, and you can guarantee if they bin Lennon tomorrow, the phone will be ringing to fucking Martin O'Neill or Roy Keane.
It'll be John Kennedy. That's what we'll get landed with, man. It'll be fucking John Kennedy will step into the end of the season. See what you've said there? I've always thought this about Celtic, right? What you've just mentioned there, the behind-the-scenes stuff is sometimes really pathetic, even down to the ticket office building and stuff compared to, like, Man United and things like that. Even the season tickets, when they went digital and stuff, it just didn't really work right, and everything seems a bit half-assed. See, when you're trying to get on to log in and watch a Celtic game through that virtual season ticket, we've all paid £500 to watch these games on the fucking telly, and you can't get in. It's pathetic. Some of the stuff just seems to be let it rot and just get by. Just get by. That's what Celtic's motto should be. Just get fucking by.
We Stephen had drinks in the tavern, fucking works in the ticket office. And it's absolutely well worse running about the European games and the Old Firm games and that. All cunts phone up to get tickets and all that and handing them back. Just no procedure whatsoever for who's in the waiting list or who's meant to get them or anything. It's just, the full club is just... Been happy to coast, mate.
And that's horrible, that, man, because see, when you could have actually really done something and progressed right on and started to, like, take Scotland, well, they did take Scotland by the scruff of the neck last 9 years and stuff, but really progress in Europe and invest in it and invest in all this back stuff, they never fucking dare. And then we end up here, we end up getting fucking fences down and sack a board and that. Fucking bastards. Anyway, sorry. No more.
Could women play in men's sport, i.e., with men?
That's a really good question. That I've been thinking about it all day, actually, when Coffee was sitting with England.
I found that one today, actually.
Can women play in men's sports, i.e. with men? Why
with
did
men?
We need that,
no, I don't mean can women play men's sports. I mean, can men and women play in professional capacity together in the same sport?
Well, I read the other day that they've just introduced somewhere, I think it's Spain or somewhere, Argentina, somewhere, that they've got the first transgender lady playing in the women's league. They've just announced that. So maybe another question to add into your answer. Mm.
Are they 7 foot tall and 240 pounds?
There's a college team in America that posted up on their Instagram this week that they're gonna have a women's quarterback for their next game, which is interesting.
What? Wow.
All right.
Okay.
As long as the defensive line can protect her and not get smashed by a 300-pound giant, then she's got it. Right?
Or keep staring at her ass when she's bent over. And it's just decoy.
Ah, I love it. That Spankle will help cut that. Ah, I love it. Well done.
Does it depend on the sport a wee bit?
Well, it does, because, like, obviously, mixed doubles in tennis and that.
Aye, of course, yeah.
You've got the lassie who's in the darts. I can't remember her name.
Mm-hmm. I know what you mean.
She qualified for the Premier League, so she was in the top 10 players in the world, and she held her own in that tournament. So, at a darts level, if they're dedicated enough, 100%, and snooker, theoretically, nobody's ever really done it or came close, but it could happen in these sports. It's just the physical ones make
contact
it more difficult.
They were talking about it in MMA. I was like, what? MMA? You've got it. Just doesn't... I mean, biologically, that just doesn't make sense. You know what I'm saying? Aye. It's just going to... Well, I'll certainly know, but... Well, you never know, I suppose. You never know. You may get a wee bird from Motherwell doing with hairy knuckles and that. You know what I mean? Come in and punch fuck at the guy.
One thing that I've thought before, and this is maybe something that's more feasible in some ways, is the prospect of a female coach or manager successfully of a male team professionally. Right. You know, but it would probably take, it would need to be somebody like building it right up for the lowest league, whatever, and like being absolutely amazing and just being that good that she kind of get ignored, and then she gets to the next well, everyone gets to the next job, and before you know it, she's like Man City.
I've got a fucking job for her.
You mean Celtic, aye, aye.
Aye, right enough, aye.
Aye, that sounded quite innuendo.
I know, it did, aye, fuck's sake.
No, I definitely meant Celtic, yeah. Nothing's off the table here.
What female manager would you like to see at Celtic, sorry?
Don't know any female managers, man. Like none, zero. I don't know any female managers.
We're getting our first, the Champions League on Wednesday night this week's getting its first ever female ref.
Is that right?
That right?
French lassie, she's going to do a game.
They've had lines women before, haven't they?
Aye, but that's the first time she's actually in charge of a proper game. She's French, she does Ligue 1 every week. Apparently she's really good, but aye, so at least there's
been a fucking Mason, that's for sure.
I suppose the question is, why have they not been so far? Why has it been segregated in the first place?
I think for sports like darts and snooker, the idea in the 70s and 80s, a woman getting into those places just wasn't for fucking
they
happening.
They weren't in the
kitchen. Well, I don't think the women themselves would have wanted to go in there because of the misogyny they'd have faced, but also they were fucking stinking. Fucking fags and heavy and all that. They wanted to get in there.
We still play gigs in some of these places.
I know.
Available for bookings.
But genuinely, you know, I mean, some of the social clubs and that you still play in, it's like...
Well, how come you never see, like, you know, if you get into a pub, there's never a women's pool team or a women's darts team. You know what I mean? There's never that. So maybe that's why they don't take it up.
In the 1980s, Eric Bristow, when he was a darts champion, was married to the women's darts champion. So they were like the golden couple of darts. The flying arrows.
Greatest sports star and or greatest sports team ever, and by sports team like a specific team of players within an era as opposed to like just the team.
For me, for greatest sports star, for me it'll always be Tiger Woods, I think. To come back and win that one after all the shagging and all that he'd done previously, I mean anybody else would have just went fuck this, I'm done, man. But he's like, no. Basically, his doctor tell him before he get the back surgery, he's like, I can get you walking again, but I'll be struggling to get you to swing a club again. And then the current wins the fucking Masters. It's the most unbelievable story you'll never see anything like it again. So for me, for him to go through all that, to win all the things he did in the first place with the dedication and the brilliance that he showed, and then shag yourself out of the game for 10 years and then come back and fucking win the hardest tournament of all, that'll never be beaten sport, that story.
He's the whole reason that no women play golf.
Aye, just get them away. the non-Tiger tour, it's called.
That is a misogynistic sport.
Well, women's golf is quite big, though. There's no reason why they shouldn't play together either.
The problem with that is that, like, the American golf courses are like 200 yards longer a hole than they can hit. Do you know what I mean? They've just not got the power to hit the ball that far. Whereas if you pick courses where the holes were like a moderate length, they probably could compete quite easily because they've got the same skills.
They've got different tees, don't they? The female tees further up.
Even just like golf clubs, some of them don't let women be members in that still.
Aye, there's one in Scotland, definitely. It's fucking shocking.
They don't even let loads of different people be members for loads of different reasons. You need to wear the right shit in that, you need to wear the right clothes, and it's total ancient behaviour.
Well, there wasn't a black guy allowed at Augusta to about fucking when Tiger turned up, I think.
Is that right?
Oh, aye. Wait,
seriously, aye. Well, fucking hell.
I only think they admitted black members to the course about 10 years ago or something like that, but...
Fucking hell.
Aye.
I'm sure I heard about... There was a wee bit of controversy about a Scottish golf club recently that would...
A couple of years ago,
never
I think,
let,
aye.
Never let females in.
Aye, they had a vote on it and they still said no. It was like...
It could be anyone, to be honest.
I think a lot of them are.
Carnoustie.
I think it was maybe
May have been.
I can't remember, but it was in the news and everything. It was in the news. A whole lot.
Carnoustie is quite misogynistic though as well.
It was either Carnoustie or Coville Park. I forget one.
Hey, mate, by the way, I used to remember at Coville Park. And it's exactly like that, 100%.
That's just some place at Coville Park, isn't it? I've never played golf
in it. It's a time warp.
Aye, especially the hall and stuff like that.
My mum and dad got married there.
That right?
Aye, that was where they had the reception, aye.
Was it like that? I was going to say, was it still like that with the stage?
I think it was brand new back then, aye.
Aye, but was it? Aye, that's what I mean. That barrier's crazy, isn't it? Keep the audience away from you completely.
Aye, it's a tough gig, aye.
Tough gig.
But see, the pub I was working in over the summer there, last month, Tenants, it was the last pub, I think, definitely in Glasgow, or maybe in Scotland, to allow women in 1975.
No, mate, there's a pub in Wishy called Tam Parts that's like still like that. There's no women allowed in, honestly.
Fucking hell.
It's crazy stuff, man.
A pub?
Tam Parts, I think it's called. Can't mind the name of it, but either a woman are not allowed into it. Fucking nuts. Absolutely.
Remember the days when the woman used to phone the pub phone to find out where their man's been?
Aye.
Aye. <That's that.
laughs> I know, I'm not here. But by the way, they may have changed that, I don't know, in case I'm slating a pub here. But
I used to go to Mall Games when I was dead young. They used to announce it at the tannoy, oh, by the way, Mr. McGee, your fucking wife's just wrapped your third way and you better go to the fucking hospital today.
Best sports team ever, Donny.
That's fucking hard, mate.
Or even a top couple, whatever.
Well, obviously, I've been watching a lot of Barca over the years, and Barcelona's team under Pep for about 2009 to 2011 will take a lot of beating. Motherwell team that won the 1991 Scottish Cup, obviously. although most of them are dead now, so it's... generally, I guess the All Blacks is the main answer, just because... That country's got like fucking 1.5 million people, and to maintain that level of consistently brilliant teams with that's such a small population, mm-hmm. Like we've got three times as many people as them, and we're shite.
Aye. Every sport.
Aye. So like the dedication and the amount of time they invest to make sure that team is absolute pinnacle. So what to be said for that?
Are we still good at curling though? The Scottish team are fucked that as well now.
Who knows?
I like the Bulls. I like watching Scotland at the Bulls.
Oh, we're good at the Bulls, aren't we?
I watch the Bulls, man. The Bulls is some... See, when it gets to the semis now, man, it's fucking gripping shit. I'm telling you, man, honestly. Me and my wee granny, Bet, used to watch that after school every day, watch the Bulls and stuff when it's on, and it's great. World Championship's fucking brilliant, man.
Although brilliant. You need to have a couple of COVID tests for the audience in that place, or else you'd fucking wipe it.
Aye. A fucking bad flu would take that out, mate.
What about you, Neil? Sports team? Best sports team ever? Greatest sports star ever?
Harlem Globetrotters.
I've no idea, man. Like, does it have to be team or just a single sports person? Or
sports person or team, aye. Just any MD you think's worth a wee mention.
Are you a sporty guy, Neil? Are you like me? It's just
I'm not... Well, no, see, I've never been into sports as much. I mean, I suppose... I can say something cliche like Muhammad Ali or something like that. That's just a great all-rounder, but I haven't really...
Well, these guys are goats for a reason. I've just found out what goats
means. Well, what does that mean? That's a very...
Greatest of all time.
Is that what that means? I did not know that.
Any who's got a story like the kind of Tiger Woods thing, I like a kind of all-rounder, mm-hmm. Not just like they were great at one match or whatever, but yeah, had a whole controversy to deal with or whatever. Anything like that. I don't think I've got any specific one, but...
I'm trying to think of other examples of something like that.
Muhammad Ali, I need to mention... For what he came up against in terms of his country's sort of attitude at the time where he was successful. Obviously, the famous story when he won his gold medal or whatever, and then he came back to America and he was trying to get served like a coffee or a meal in a restaurant, and they wouldn't serve him because the colour of his skin, you know, stuff like that. To make it through those sorts of times, that's an achievement in itself, you
definitely,
know.
Man.
But what a showman and what a personality, Muhammad Ali.
Aye, the best ones always transcend the sport they're in. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like Lewis Hamilton faces a lot of the same problems, in my opinion, in F1 that Ali faced, but in a mere modern environment. Because obviously, Lewis Hamilton gets 30 million a season, but doesn't he drink? Doesn't he take drugs? Doesn't he do any of that stuff? So what does he spend his money on? He buys fucking planes and shit because that's all he can buy. And yet there's still a significant portion, I think, of Britain that resents him for that success, and it's pretty maddening and quite sad, but it's still
they resent him. Why do they resent him?
Just seen a lot of hate from recently because his stance with the BLM and all that. Seen a lot of hate from recently, aye, man.
Mm-hmm. Hated them. Just people try to dress it up any reason they like.
Aye.
Some people just don't like a black man dominating a predominantly white man sport.
That's it.
It's as simple as that. I mean, like, you're talking about the average audience of F1 these days is still people in their 40s and stuff like that, and they still might have some backward views. I don't want to attack everybody with the same brush because he's still got a gigantic fan base and a lot of people love him, but there are some people out there that just want to say, oh, you've only because you've got the best car, that's why you're winning.
I've heard a lot of that.
All that shite and stuff. It's like, well, that happens in every sport, do you know what I mean? Like, why does Pep Guardiola not take over Exeter? Well, because he's the best at what he does. Why the fuck would he want to manage Exeter? You're a dick.
I know.
That's what I'm saying. Why does fucking Gordon Ramsay not work in Greggs? Like, I mean, because
that would be amazing.
It would be amazing.
Imagine Gordon Ramsay working in Denham's.
Do you know if this Denham's place?
Kitchen nightmares.
But Donnie.
What, in Mull High Street?
Aye. That is legendary, aye.
Been there for about 100 years, hasn't it?
Aye. 20 in!
I'd love to see Gordon Ramsay getting in there and sorting out
the cream yum yums.
Try to swear
your cream yum yums are shit. I love that show, man. Diabetes, but I love it.
Gordon Ramsay used to play for Rangers, is he? Fact that we probably know, but it'd be worth a mention. Is that right? I'm sure that's right.
I think he played a couple of practice games with him and that, but
isn't he exactly a legend, I wouldn't say.
Played with Rangers in inverted commas.
I was going to pick him for my best sports star ever. What about you, Swanny? Any
greatest sports team ever? Simpson, Craig Gilmore. Obviously the Lions. Greatest sports stars just passed away. Dago.
What about you, Mark?
I've not got a clue. Really. Being a music man, I probably can't answer that.
Was that right?
The Boston Green Sox.
The Carnoustie Salinas. Come back to me on that. I'm not sure.
Come back to you? When, like, tomorrow or something? I can give you a text later.
Well, the thing with Maradona is, like, the one thing that I've took for the last week, just watching and reading stuff about him, it's fucking shite to be famous, man. Like, really famous, famous as him. Like, the guy couldn't do anything and just took advantage of everywhere he went, particularly when he went to Naples and everybody wanted a piece of him, and then
I know.
Obviously Sicilian mob and all that got a hold of him and the Camorra and made sure that he was fucking making them coin every single day, and just like that full entourage that comes with being famous, it just looks absolutely shit, man.
Used and abused, didn't he, a lot of the guys? Did you see that documentary when he managed a team in, like, fucking, I don't know where it was, like Kazakhstan or something like that? There was a Netflix thing and he went away over there and they followed him, and it's fascinating. He was absolutely shite managing them, but he was in a bad way, you know, and you can see what you were talking about. There was a lot of hangers on.
Aye.
Bit like Gaza was a bit like that, wasn't
it? Well, we were thinking about this the other day, and we were trying to think to somebody as close as you could find, and certainly no in terms of, like, Gaza was brilliant, but certainly no anywhere near Maradona, but that same level of, well, the English in particular, I tell them all the time down here, that they love to build somebody up, then utterly destroy them, and then just pick up the pieces of what's left. That's the favourite thing to do in the world. They did that with Gaza, and that's how he's seen as a sympathetic figure now, even though they're the ones that destroyed him in the first place, kind of thing.
Aye.
And I think, like with Maradona, like, you're talking about a guy that had his own fake penis, do you know what I mean, to give drug tests, because the Camorra made sure that he wasn't going to get a banner in like that, so they gave him a rubber dick to put down his drawers when he was
fucking
a piss. Stuff like that. But you can only imagine, like, not to get into a fucking a drug conversation, but you can only imagine the purity of the stuff he must have been taking. It must have been literally, like, fucking, like,
I wasn't a council mate.
Exactly, right out of the Pope, right? The fucking guy, the guy had mental health problems, he had a troubled relationship with life in general to begin with. And he himself always said there was two people, there was Diego and there was Maradona, and one couldn't really exist without the other, and one had to become the other in public because he just couldn't hack it. I mean, there's a story during the week there about he got an audience with the Pope, and he couldn't handle it, he was dead nervous, so he went into the fucking bog at the Vatican and done a couple of charges. come back out and tell fucking Pope John Paul, you want to feed the poor, why don't you sell the fucking gold ceiling?
That's it. Well, I agree with Diego there. I wonder if the Pope took a patsy. Oh, I mean, I wonder if the Pope was in there while I'm chatting with the disabled door like that's in Diego.
I guess this kind of ties in with the other podcast we've been working on, Donny, but what role will AI play in the future of sport?
It'll probably fucking ruin it, to be honest, because you're talking about any competitive advantages at the moment that are on the kind of edge of things. It allows weird teams and that to go and exploit them for a short period of time until it works its way up the chain, and they want the ones at the top get the best gear and the better versions and more efficient versions of what's available further down the gear, and then they need to find another edge, but eventually the edges run out on the sport, and I think it will just make it, it's already starting to make it a bit more perfect, do you know what I mean? And sport should be imperfect. It should be people filled with flaws, and the game itself should be filled with flaws, and that's another VAR conversation and all that shit as well. But the more advances that you make, the more that you're taking the edges away for like crazy and amazing stories. And I think depressingly that's probably going to be the case. And don't get me wrong, like what Zone 7, that AI company, are doing is they're preventing injuries and making life better for players and their well-being. But what it also does is, what injuries do at the moment is it brings the good teams down towards the weird teams, because Van Dijk getting injured, they know, means other teams have got a chance, whereas if everybody's fit all the time, it means all the big teams that are spending a load of money in these players, they're fit and they're ready and available, and that's obviously a massive advantage against the weird teams. So it's probably going to make it a bit less competitive, to be honest, but it's one of the ones, it's like once progress sort of starts, it's very difficult to wheel it back.
Do you know how that works? The injury prediction? Is it just like algorithms and stuff like that?
What happens is, mate, like pretty much every team now, they all wear that wearable technology, so like the kind of sports bras and all that, that gather your movement.
Is that what that is?
Aye, it's all data that's gathered, so like you've got years and years and years of data. Even the worst teams do this now, and they've all got wearable tech that gathers that data for them. So what the AI does is it plugs into the technology and basically runs it through the algorithm, and it looks at that player's injury history. So if Scott Brown, for example, has a history of groin problems or like a calf injury or something, it will take that into account of when other players he has profile might hit the red zone and then go into a sustained period of training where they might get injured, and then it recommends an audited training program for them to go and work on something else. So rather than running that day, he'll send Brown to the gym or whatever to work on kind of weightlifting, or send him to the sauna, or send him wherever, that just keeps the weight off that injury that could happen. And they reckon they've got it up to like 80% predictiveness now in terms of preventing people getting injured who would have got injured without the technology in place. So they're working with like 20 teams now across the world, and it's like really successful. Like Getafe is one of the teams that they work with in Spain. A couple of years ago, they had the lowest budget in the entire league by a distance, and they finished sixth in the league, getting to Europa League. So
incredible.
It shows you it can work, and it shows you that, like I say, that edge is there if teams want it. And I think it's now as good a time forever for people to be starting to look at it, because folk are dropping like flies the other place. So if you can get an edge that makes sure that your best players, I mean, Swanee, I mean, look at, Celtic played Fernand Varos, and Odson Edzard is sitting in his fucking ass. If Celtic had any technology that could have meant, right, we'll keep Odson out of this game, and we'll keep him out of training this week so that he plays that game's worth £30 million to Celtic or whatever. So like the technology pays for itself in a short period of time if it's utilised properly.
We've got fucking Stratton and Kennedy running about with an iPad in the dugout. See, when that second goal went in yesterday, the camera panned over to the dugout, and Lennon and Stratton were looking at a MacBook. I was like, what the fuck is going on here? What the fuck is going on? What can they possibly be looking at that MacBook about? You know, so I think you're right. There's a good and bad side with everything in AI. And, you know, it's, I think there's, like you say, it's going to take a lot of the wee cup upsets away and all that kind of stuff, what makes football fucking football, really, doesn't it? But then again, does it, you know, keep your greatest players playing longer? And does it mean that we're going to get an extra 5 years out of a Messi or something like that? And, you know, so good and bad with it all. I mean, I despise VAR, absolutely despise it, like probably most folk now, just killing the excitement. I mean, you can't celebrate a goal. you celebrate a goal, you go, oh, is that a goal? You know what I mean? Fucking brutal, that. So
I never realised that those wee sort of sports vest, sports bra type things that you mentioned there, I never knew that's where that was.
I honestly
never knew that. Mate, I thought that was just like a sort
big
of,
Apple Watch.
Fashion, but like a sort of...
Mate, you can get them, my mate wears it playing fucking five a side.
Aye, there's folk, you see them all running
the shoes,
them,
man.
That's amazing. I'd never heard of this at all.
Well, see, even
that
just,
is actually amazing.
See, even if you look at what the, you know, your Fitbits and your Apple Watches actually gather now in your health app and stuff like that, it's fucking mental. I woke up the other day there and my phone told me I had like 78% quality sleep. I'm like, what the fuck's it going today with you? You know what I mean? That's 78% quality sleep, you slept for 6 hours, you got up for a piss at 4:30. I'm like, for fuck's sake, you're worse than the missus. So even like that level of stuff, you know, layman's terms, it's, they gather everything. I mean, it's great, I suppose.
But the thing is, though, not just AI, but technology in general, right? So, like Bryson DeChambeau in the golf now, rattling the ball fucking 375 yards, they're having to dig up courses and that to get it to...
Aye.
Basically changing how you play the game. That's what I don't like. I think in a sport like that, they should be putting limitations on the technology.
Well, that's very...
It for miles.
That's very interesting that you should say that, because we've spoken about AI before and your man Elon Musk and all that on the Joe Rogan podcast, talking about how it's just no regulated at all. You know, from top to bottom, they've not really got regulation within AI as yet, and it's a thing that's going to learn itself and progress itself, so that's probably something that should be regulated more than anything, and they've just not got that. So I think there's a wee bit of me that's I'm a skeptic with anything like that. I'm going, is there something, you know, really dark with it as well? Is really
it's
good.
It's fucking deciding elections, mate. I mean,
aye, that's it. That's
Facebook's just running on a very simple algorithm, and it's deciding to feed up to people. Like I was in a call with a boy last week, and we're just chatting about it was a work related thing, and then I could tell he was chipping away about the fucking lockdown stuff and all that, right? So I was like, right, let's get it off your chest, mate, so we can move on with our lives here. And this fucking... I thought previously this guy was like kind of quite level-headed and that. Fuck me, man. He had me down the garden path. But it was stuff like... He's like, well, as we all know, like, the vaccines that are going to be injected in your body have got metal in them. And I'm like, whoa. Like, as I know, what are you talking about? Like, where are you getting that from? And always you're getting that from
a meme?
Fake news source. Like, the metal's going to get in your body... they can track you from the blood stream. I'm like, mate, you've got a fucking phone in your pocket that's got your best tell Google your location now. You might want to turn that off, bud. Do you know what I mean?
I love the anti-vaxxers, man. I love the anti-vaxxers. I love all that shit. That's not getting in my fucking body. And then the next 40s, they're eating a Rustler burger.
We'll see how much they want to fucking take a vaccine when they're stoked for going to Benidorm next year.
Mate.
They won't let them in the country.
Exactly.
Is it not the theory that vaccinated so that the 5G mask, the government can just kill anyone
just
they want?
Brains, man.
That'd be great. Imagine you got a job in that department, you could just fucking press the enter button every time somebody walked by you didn't like. That'd be
great. People have probably got some legitimate concerns with the vaccines and that. I'm totally pro-vaccine and stuff, but I think people think because it's been done so quickly that there must be a problem with it. But I think you need to look at that in the reverse and you should say, well, that's how quick it should be. Why has it took so long for, like, vaccines for other diseases?
So that's the thing, Merv, right? So, sorry to cut you off, bud, but, like, I'd literally had this conversation yesterday. The pure reason for it is money, right? See, all these other vaccines for these other diseases, they can all largely wait, right? Obviously, there's loads of cancer research and they spend billions on that every year and they're getting there with that. But the other, like, smaller scale things, they all need funding for somewhere and the funding's got to come from a place that the pharmaceutical companies know that the doses are going to be wanted, right? So, like, in 2005, when SARS came out, there was money getting chucked at a SARS vaccine right, left and centre, right? And there were fucking as many teams competing to get the vaccine as there has been for this. And then all of a sudden, they realised that, actually, this isn't killing anybody, so nobody's going to want it. And bang, funding gone, nay SARS vaccine, right? But they know that the longer this has been on, the mayor that it's just fucking buying money. If you're AstraZeneca or whatever, you're literally buying money for the future by just funding and funding and funding this. So the pure simple fact is, a lot of these other vaccines, they get one or two people working on it at a time with a limited budget based on the expected revenue they're going to generate back. Whereas in this case, they've got every cunt working on it, spending billions on it, because they know there's going to be the money at the end of the rainbow because everybody's going to want to take it. So that's why it's worked.
Big Neil, Big Shugs is an anti-vaxxer, aren't you, Shugs? Aye.
Oh, are you?
I've never had a vaccine, ever.
Any vaccines?
Nothing. No, I don't tend to get... Well, I had the BCG when I was in school, but...
Aye, the one you get at school, aye.
Aye, but I've never had any flu jab or anything like that.
Aye, neither have I. Is any, you guys had flu jabs or that?
I had a TB.
No, I never had a flu jab.
TB,
aye. Vaccine.
Nah, the TB, aye, nothing else.
It's not like now. Like, my daughter, she's had more jags than I've had in my entire lifetime.
And is
like,
that right?
In under a year. It's mental. She's...
MMR and all that.
All the time, man. All the time. It's bizarre. It's bizarre.
Should doping be legalised? Is this in sport, I take it?
Aye.
100%.
Aye, definitely.
100%, mate.
I know.
Like, for the same reasons that the edge has been taken away by technology and AI, the best dopers are the best runners. Do you know what I mean? Like, Lance Armstrong's dope wasn't something you can buy out the shop. Do you know what I mean? The best fucking gear, and that's why one of them. Like, the same as anything else, like, you buy what you can afford, and you get the best dopers at the top level because they charge more. So you'd be better off fucking just injecting them all and see if you can get somebody to run under 9 seconds, do you know what I mean, than making them fucking...
I think, like, it'd be great.
Comply to these bullshit rules that you know they're not keeping to it anyway.
No, like, that's it.
Put the last 50 guys that ran fucking under 10 seconds, I think 49 of them have been caught. The only one that's not been caught is Usain Bolt. Like, all the rest of them have been stuck for the record. And it's just like, what's the fucking point in this?
Maybe they should take it further and have, like, invent new sports that are literally, like, drug taking, and see who can, like, have the quickest
drug Olympics. Quickest record.
Just every pub in the west of Scotland you're describing a Saturday night.
That's a sport that Scotland would actually be decent at.
Fair. Donny, did you not tell me a while ago that the technology to catch doping is behind the technology to create the drugs?
10 years behind, 15 years behind, mate.
Is that right?
Like, well, there's a lot more money to be made in being a lucrative athlete than there is stopping lucrative athletes being people. Do you know what I mean? There's a lot more money on one side of the equation than there is in the other, and that, when that's the case, it's much harder. Like, when Armstrong was getting tested regularly in the beginning, all they did with Armstrong was change it to what his team called it as microdosing. So basically, the test that came out was to check if EPO had been in the bloodstream for like a certain period of time. And what they just did was they just lessened the period. So they just microdosed, which was literally poke it in their system, and that would last them for 4 hours for the duration of a time trial or whatever. And then they would still pass clean at the end of it. So like the amount of money that's involved in, even you wouldn't believe, like, I've really know that arsed about cycling around in terms of watching it on the telly or anything like that, but fucking all my mates and that are for like France, Germany, Netherlands, fucking we sit and watch full 100-mile races all summer, like all the tours and all that. They absolutely love it, and there's so much money at the top of it that it just it's so lucrative to make sure that you are the fastest cheater, pretty much. I mean, that's as simple as that.
Kind of doting could snooker players use.
Diazepam.
Blues.
Why don't you put it? That's a diazepam in that. If you just took it right, a dose.
Steady.
Steady your arm on it. Make you hit the ball straighter.
Aye, you wouldn't like flinch and all that. Get the flinches. Aye, suppose
you didn't.
Right.
As long as you didn't fall asleep on the black and like that.
And
so I think you should do a column on the fact that doping and drugs in that is pretty much just like having the better trainers and.
Aye.
In any sport or whatever. Yeah,
look at this. Look at your man, Bill. This is the kind of stuff that gets you sued, right? But fuck. look at Salazar. That guy's him. Salazar had a relationship with Nike, who had a relationship with fucking Mo Farah. Like, Mo Farah's fucking.
Fucking yeah.
Like, oh, what a magical story. He came from fucking nowhere. All of a sudden, he's winning fucking back to back Olympics. Are you right, bud? Fucking joker, man. and like, there's a lot to be said for investigating that full fucking British team in 2012. There's a lot of dodgy stuff going on there.
A lot of medals, aye. Shouldn't have, which aye. Is unusual.
No, it was like fucking them winning the Eurovision. I'm like, what's going on here? They shouldn't be winning all this shit.
In Beijing, they won like fucking 5 chocolate medals, and then all of a sudden they're all up at fucking. GB's fucking tearing the thing up.
I feel as if there's too many Olympic sports, like, you know, you've got 100 metres, 200 metres, 300 metres, 400, like X amount of metres, and it's not really that popular, or I'm guessing it's not really that popular a sport, athletics, compared to like football, whatever. So to make it more competitive and get the best of the best, I think it should reduce the numbers. So maybe like a short sprint, and then like a mid distance, and then like a marathon, and that's it. And you need to pick it. You need to pick the event that suits you best, because you can pick any old shit, really. You know what I mean? A walking race, or like a short putt, discus. I mean, spin. Who came up with that shit? Who actually sat and came up with that? Hammer throw?
You could. I'm thinking about this here. You could solve two of these things. So you could get like a 100 or 200 meter race and have a mixed gender, so men and women, as we were talking about earlier, but just dope the women. So you've got massive women that are ready to go against, against the guys. What?
Massive women, did you say?
Aye, because there'll be steroids and that, innit?
Oh, right, okay. Right, I get you.
You know, see, they done a mixed relay race at the World Championship like a year ago.
Did they?
It was dead funny. Because they could put no funny in the way like haha, let's laugh at women, but like they could put the woman at any point in the four, right? So you had like a woman at the start, like 20 seconds behind, and then there was a woman going last with like a 25 second lead, getting caught in things. Just it made no sense.
So like back to the second question, what we should do is dope all the women.
Aye,
the
that's what I'm saying. Aye,
that'll be an interesting three-legged races at the end, man. I can't help.
I think it's just inherent, if you're a guy, you can't help but feel like there's a small part that it's always going to be like that. It's, you're always going to have that mind of, well, man, go do work, woman is a bit less, but that's horrible.
I'd imagine humans would evolve and it might be more equal in about 1,000 years time or something.
But the thing is, the problem, so if you made it all regulated and that, it's actually a lot safer than what's happening the new, because because it's all unspoken, these folk could be taking anything. They could be getting fed anything by anybody, or take this for a couple of months and I'll help you get to the top and all that. That's more dangerous than it is saying, right, we don't want people to start dying here, so we can regulate what they take, we can regulate the drugs that they take and the processes they take.
It's the same argument as legalising drugs for recreational use, isn't it? Really?
That's a guess, aye.
Yeah. Is there any rules about like getting, like, I don't know, down the line with technology improves, maybe people will start getting like man-made legs and that, like electronic.
All right,
aye. Paralympics,
man. That's it.
Electronic metal
aye.
Legs. I know, but I'm talking about really fast legs, so people will sacrifice their legs to get.
That's like fucking face off.
That's the future.
A bit Blade Runner-esque, that kind of thing. Was it augmentation? I think it's called. Yeah.
Aye.
If you actually choose to get your legs replaced, a couple of fast legs.
Basketball. Would you rather have teeth or a house to call your own? The Samba game, or would you rather? Would you rather?
That makes absolutely no sense.
Lovely.
Right, thanks, mate. Would you rather keep VAR or get rid of it?
VAR.
VAR.
The soccer ball.
Would you rather keep VAR or get rid of it?
At this point, get rid of it.
Hang. Get it to fuck.
Yeah.
Aye.
Aye. That's that finished. Next section.
Right, cool. Next section.
I would actually. I'd play devil's advocate, as you say. And I was kind of thinking about this. I think I would keep it because.
Danny and Kenan.
Nah, just get.
Is it not fair? Is it not like you beat?
Oh,
it's
not. It's not
like
fair, no.
It's like the days before CCTV with crime investigation, and now it's, you know, crimes are getting solved rightly because of CCTV, is it not the same hang?
Aye, but I don't want to spend 9 months in court to find out if my team scored, do you know what I mean?
I know.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. We're waiting forever. Also, like, they're trying to make subjective rules objective here.
Aye, okay,
offside,
yeah.
And, like, Offside's maybe a problem for me than handball, because offside, the technology literally doesn't exist, so the frame rate of the cameras can't even tell when the ball leaves the player's foot versus when it actually goes through to the player that they're passing it to, and yet they're chopping off a goal for fucking toenails.
Mm.
The technology literally doesn't exist, and yet we're just...
I know. But maybe it's getting there. If you're saying, you know, about that vest and that, and that you can plug that in, and it brings, you know, tells you, predicts injuries, which is mental, that's amazing. If you can get that, sure, you could get technology where it's in the player's boots, it's in the ball, it's the whole thing, just in a split setting.
You can, mate, you're right, offside. And that would be better, but to me, it stands against what the point of the offside rule was. The offside rule was to stop people like me who are lazy cunts standing up front and just smashing in the goal.
Maybe they should get out of the offside.
Well, I've thought about writing about that, but I need to speak to a referee, you know that, because they spoke about doing some practice games at a lower level, which is in the offside, just to see what would happen, because it's one of the ones, you know, you're not really sure how the game develops until you actually tested it out. But I'd be interested to see what kind of game it would be like, because... Who nobody likes offside? It's shite.
I've seen like games on YouTube, like ancient games before offside and stuff, and it is just they always keep like one right up top. Do you know what I mean?
But the counter argument to that is like goalies back in the day used to just stand on the line and they weren't very good on the ball and like that. Whereas goalies now are much more agile on that and better players. So you might lose a bit of benefit because he can come out and challenge that player and you wouldn't maybe get as much out of it. But I do think you still need offside. What I'm just not happy about is getting goals chopped off for like just have a look at the camera. Does he look offside? No. Fucking go on, mate, then.
Aye. See all this like measuring it and getting lines out and all that. God, to fuck.
Aye, that's too much. I just feel as if this whole thing was the start with, maybe it's just in my mind, maybe it was the same everywhere, but I just feel as if it was always English pundits talking about this for years before it happened, because like that Frank Lampard goal that they should have scored in the World Cup or the European Cup, whatever it was, that was well over the line but didn't get counted and stuff like that.
That was great, man.
I feel as if it's just always been them talking about it in Sky Sports News 24 hours a day every time there's a wrong decision. Aye. For so long, and eventually it's came in and they fucking hate it.
It's true, mate. It's like, I mean? It's they've battered the ref. Like, I'm not going to fucking defend referees because they're as bad as ever, but like Sky Sports on a fucking Monday morning literally does ref watch where they sit with an old referee on the panel and he basically picks apart all the decisions. And you're sitting there going, well, what's you fucking do then?
Imagine somebody done that at your work, just sat like the next day, went over everything that you done wrong. You'd be, fuck it, I'd be, ah, fuck that. Who does that job, man? You know what I mean? Who the fuck wants to do that job? I don't understand. You must be sadomasochistic to be a referee. You must be, because the abuse that you guys take. And see, when we're talking about offside, like a linesman, I've always thought of, you know, even by the time that you've lifted your eyes from the guy hitting the ball to look at the guy that's the furthest for the the line, you know, that even that split setting is out, you know, so...
Impossible.
I like that, though, you know, I like it when... Well, obviously it's shite when it goes against you, but...
Will it be like a fad that comes and goes, like golden goal and stuff like that?
Is here to
stay?
It's here to stay, mate. It's the same as what Donnie's saying. Once these things come in, it's really hard to rein them back.
But the only people that can take them out again are the referees, right? And the referees fucking love this because it just takes all the responsibility off them. I didn't make the decision. The fucking boy up there did.
That's it.
The thing I was going to say, I couldn't think of the devil's advocate why they should maybe stay. I was thinking is other sports have got similar technology and other sports never complain about it. Maybe I'm wrong about that, but I feel as I like the tennis and that. You never hear them saying that needs to get... I know.
No, I mean,
but maybe they just don't know how to, but then they've got rules, don't they? They've got, you can get three challenges, so it's agreed at the start. Maybe they need to bring in some sort of...
I wasn't a big fan of that, but and the mayor that I'm looking at it, the mayor I'm inclined to agree with you, mate.
I think you should maybe do that with VAR, sorry Donnie, but I think you should do like a team's only get two shouts at a VAR. Do you know what I mean? And they've got to pick when they, you know, go, right, I want to use VAR for that to see if that was over a line or whatever. And you only get two, and that's it. So four maximum a game, and then, you know what I mean? Something like that.
I agree. It's became part of the game in tennis now, whereby, Federer should have kept that challenge here because that was definitely in, kind of thing.
Aye, strategy, isn't it?
Aye, it's part of the strategy of the game, and I would be for it now. I wasn't for it in the first place because I just thought, or cunts like Mourinho will be fucking doing a VAR in the last minute, do you know what I mean? Just for nothing, just to fucking slow the game down and things, but...
Aye, well, there is
If it came part of it, then you would get used to it. I would rather have set moments in games where you can do that versus having any number in a game now where it takes 5 fucking minutes for them to decide.
Fucking murder, mate. It's like it kills the whole game. And then it's horrible. I hate that. And they go out to the side and it just takes ages. Fucking too long, man. You need to sort that out before you introduce it into the professional game. You really do.
It's almost like, see, one's like Thierry Henry, right, with the handball against Ireland about a year ago, right? It's almost like you need a separate. That's so obviously wrong, right? If you almost had a separate layer for it, where it was that didn't even take a challenge. It was like the VAR referees looked at it instantly, and went, "That's fucking wrong, guys," or something. I don't know how you would do that though.
I know.
It becomes a slippery slope, down the way for there.
I know.
That was where it was brought. That was supposed to be brought in for things like that. No fucking Mo Salah's fucking ball here been offside.
I know. Do you see no manscape?
Well, the one at the weekend, mate, is one of the worst I've seen, because like the rule is, or it used to be, your level, your own side.
That's right.
And now
it's not new, innit? No,
you're not.
Aye, that's crazy, isn't it? Because that's harder to tell. You know, it's harder to tell the other way. You know, if you're on line is offside, it's harder to tell that You know,
but you've also got a case offside, like, sorry. Any changes that they've ever made to offside over the years. So back in the day when they introduced offside, there had to be 3 players in between. So like they took it down to 2, and then in the 90s and that, after Italia 90, because Italia 90 was boring as fuck, if you were level during Italia 90, you were offside, right? So then they changed the rules after that tournament to be mean level was onside.
Aye.
So every change that they've made to offside is to benefit the attacker and made it better to fucking score goals. That's the point of the game. But this one is the first time they've actually made a change that makes it harder to score. And that doesn't help the fucking spectacle. People watching it going, oh, well, it's loads of Mo Salah can say, right, see, the next time I make my run, I'm going to make sure that my fucking boots are an inch back that way. Like, you can't do that. That's not how football works. And, like, at least with the handball rule, people will adjust it, be like putting their hands behind their back or try to get them out of the way a bit more. There's something, in a lot of cases, that there's something they can actively do there. But with some of these offsides, there's nothing you can do to change your action to make sure that you don't get punished the next time, and that's what's wrong.
And there's a bit of us and them as well. Like, I think you mentioned that earlier about like how the bigger teams and the bigger leagues or whatever will capitalise always. They're always benefit for these things. Like, for example, country like Scotland don't have VAR now, and playing with, you could get used to it, and it could be a disadvantage if you were playing like a European game against it. You know, a team who's used to playing it when you're not used to playing it.
Aye.
With big decisions. And it's strange that there's only so, the vast majority of games don't use it. When you think of all the games that get played, it's only a few of the top leagues. You know, it's like there's a bit of a. They should probably roll these things out when it's ready to roll everywhere.
Mate, that was why FIFA kept us out of the game for years. This kind of technology has been in place for nearly a decade now. But FIFA didn't want to put it in place because the rationale was, if you can't do it up the Sunday League, up the park, you can't then apply that route with the Premier League. And then at some point, over the last 3 or 4 years, there's obviously been a lot of lobbying by these companies that are selling this technology, and FIFA have just folded on it. And now you've got different fucking rules for different competitions of the same fucking sport. Like, Europa League doesn't have it, and the fucking Champions League does.
Yeah, that's crazy.
It's nuts.
So get at it then, aye.
I get at it.
I would say keep it for the things that it's supposed to be in place for clear and obvious things. But if it's not clear and obvious, don't be drawing your fucking lines. Go in with the game.
That's Arcadia Group went into administration, by the way. Just popped up.
Aye.
Oh, jobs, man. 13,000 sort of jobs.
Fucking what did hell. They do? Were they shopping centres then? Did they just shut down?
Well, it's.
They were always going to go, they shop. See, when you think about it,
How were they always going to go?
Well, think about Brayhead, the Fort, what's the other one? Silverburn. Think of the amount of shops in those places, and the amount of shift there's been from people shopping in these places to shopping online, and the fact that they're so close, there's only so much business that can, these places need to get Got a lot of traffic coming through.
I see any of them that I've went to Bournemouth, they're always fucking heaving. Always heaving, man. Livingston is fucking mobbed in a Tuesday afternoon.
It's not what it used to be, definitely.
It's not what it used to be. It'll take, like, there'll be fine margins in that. Do you know what I mean? There'll be really fine margins in it. I'd seen a programme about this recently, and they were talking about how what they're going to do with these places when they eventually go, and, you know, what could they make them into, like, homes or whatever. Because they're going to be big, you know, empty buildings. But it's went online. That's the... That, plus obviously this. Right, COVID is just like...
I was listening to, just talk about Arcadia there. I was out in the motor earlier, and there was some, that Philip Green cunt, it was his biographer, was on the radio saying that he didn't believe in the internet. Like, he didn't believe that it was a place where people would buy things. Like, up to, like, last fucking year, he didn't believe that it was worth investing any money in. And you're like, well, fuck you then.
That's like missing the point majorly, innit?
Who's the richest guy in the world? Jeff fucking Bezos. You're funny.
I know. Like, apparently, even up until, like, 2011, when ASOS at that point were turning over, like, hundreds of millions, he's like, nah, nobody wants to buy clothes online. They want to try them on the shop.
I kind of agree with that. I hate it, man. I fucking don't know the last time I bought some online I didn't need to send fucking back.
Well, that's, you're funny you say that, mate. I just bought some stuff for my Christmas here, right? And one of the packages came this morning. And on the email I got through the company, it was the right item I'd ordered. On the front of the fucking package, it's the right item. I opened up the fucking box, the invoice was for the right item, and it was the wrong fucking thing.
Oh, fuck's sake, man.
That's what I mean. No, you need to, especially clothes, you need to go in and put it on, and sometimes I'm a bit of a woman with that. I'll go in and put it on, and I'll go and try something different, and go, no, that fits a wee bit better back here, I'll go back here and get that one. And, you know, I'm a hands-on kind of guy with that stuff, I think. I fucking hate online shopping. I fucking despise it, and it's never what you want. It's never what you want. It's never exactly what you want. See, Amazon's a fucking scam. Amazon's just a pure fucking scam. See that shit? You go in and the photo looks fucking great, and it's Wish. Amazon's Wish. You fucking buy it and you're like, and then you think you're buying a 6-foot totem pole, and then it's like a wee fucking miniature hanging that, you know what I mean? It's honest, it's a pure scam. But then they also send it in a big fuck off box, and you open my arm, it's this tiny wee hanging, this big fucking massive coffin box. What the fuck is going on in my life, man?
It's even a bigger scam than that when you think of what's actually happened. You're talking about businesses that have been around for years, have generated a lot of income, have generated a lot of wealth and a lot of jobs for people. You know, like that 13,000 there. And basically that's been transformed into warehouses where people don't have any... They certainly don't get well paid. They don't have the same... employee rights and stuff. I think it was mentioned recently, but I don't know if it was Amazon or
somewhere. That's Amazon's plan, is the word retail will be Amazon. Anything you buy will be fucking through Amazon. I think that's his plan, isn't it?
Aye, so you've changed the, like, vibrant places, vibrant shopping centres that generate loads of income for the economy, business rates and all the stuff that goes with that, you know, paying employees and everything that goes with that, and it's basically went to warehouses that are, people are undercut, overworked, and guys in vans dropping it off. Right. So think of the amount of money that's saved changing that business model.
I think, my experience of COVID and lockdowns and all that, I think it's been actually a boost for local shopping, because I'm seeing a lot more people, you know, from my estate that will be in the local butchers. Now, instead of being in their big, massive Tesco in Glasgow after their work, getting all their pre-packed meat, they're actually going to the butchers, they're going to the fruit and veg shop, and so I think there's an element of it started to make people go a wee bit more local, which is great. But I fucking can't stick online shopping. I hate it, I despise it, everything I get is wrong. It's either that or I'm just fucking cursed, you know what I mean?
The thing with the like something like ASOS, for example, right, like so you put a filter on ASOS, you're now looking at one of 45,000 fucking pairs of shoes, and it's like, what the fuck, man? Like,
narrow it down a bit.
I don't need to see all this stuff.
That's a Carol Pilkington thing, that, but it's absolutely true. There's too much choice, man.
You click through, and then you click back, and it's took half all your filters, and then you click on something you really like, and then it goes not available in medium, and fucking then you like fucking smash the screen up.
Fucking murder, mate. Absolute murder.
I don't think, in my opinion, I agree with you on clothes shopping. I don't think clothes shopping has really got it right yet in terms of...
Nah.
Like, I bought a
kind of AR thing or something.
Like, I was on, like, I'm on some fucking Ralph Lauren mailing list thing 3 years ago, and they sent me a message saying 25% off. So I went and clicked, and their fucking t-shirts are in 3 different sizes. Fit, classic fit, and super supreme slim fucking fit. And it's like, what one's what? How do I know what one is what? Before standing in the fucking shop trying to win.
That's it. That's exactly it.
Maybe eventually the technology will be, it'll fit the clothes specifically to your exact
I'll be
fit,
AR, using an like AR a, thing, but I don't know.
Using an avatar.
That, even that, though, even if it fits, you're not feeling it. You know, you're not feeling how that lies on you and your shape and your size. And you're just, it's not the same. And I find that across the board, not just with clothes, with anything, man. Anything that I buy online, I think 99% of the time I'll go, that's not exactly what I thought that was going to be. Do you know what I mean? But if I get into a shop and I come out with it, I know exactly what I fucking bought. So there's definitely an argument. It's maybe an old man thing in me, but it's...
I think the key is with online shopping is fucking... Well, I agree with you with the clothes thing. I only buy stuff that I've already picked in the shop, so I'll buy exactly the same thing. But everything else I need to research, like, fuck...
I think it depends on how generic the thing is as well, right? So I've got no problem buying a PS5 online, right?
But
see if I'm buying a new motor... I'm going to fucking see it.
Exactly.
I'll go to the garage and see it before I buy it.
Exactly. 100%. Aye, absolutely. So there's always going to be a need for footfall, I think. And like I say, with these big shopping centres that are closed, I don't know the last time I was in any of them that I locally go to. The ones that you mentioned in particular, Merv, Silverburn, Brayhead, Livingston, all the ones run about me, they're always fucking heaving with people on it. And do you know, see, it's a social thing as well, because there's a lot of, like, Keane's age, they'll go and meet in Silverburn, then they'll go to the cinema, and then they'll go and buy something about River Island and bowling. And so there's, you know, maybe a bit Americanized that with the kids, you know, going to the mall. But
aye, we lived in London for a year. We went to that Westfield, and that is fucking my physical idea of hell, that place, man.
Aye, yeah.
1 million shops just stacked on top of each other.
Fuck that.
10 million people on it. It's just a horrible place.
Fuck that, man. I'd freak out. What's the opposite for it is agoraphobic, isn't it? That's what I'm like in the places, man. I'm like, oh, I need to go here. Fucking hell, I need to go here. And I lift with 20 folk. Some fat bastard on one of the fucking moped things. And you
look, I've got a 5-person queue, right? So see if there's more than 5 people in the queue, anything, I'm not working that shop.
I'm the same, mate. In traffic jams, I'll go a 25-mile fucking detour if there's 5 in a traffic jam, you know what I mean? That's just the men in his butt, isn't it? That's a man thing, that. I can't, no patience at all.
Yes, I was just, I immediately jumped to the point of view that the person behind the counter is a fucking idiot, and that's why the queue's so long.
Aye. That's it. You know the premise of this then, Donny? It's not hard, I suppose. Got to read out some names and you just tell me if they're a banger or a saint, in your opinion. Ronnie O'Sullivan.
Oh, he's a saint, man. Don't you get any reason for it, or just...
If you don't want it, don't bother. It's up to you, mate. If you want to elaborate, elaborate.
Because one of the big problems that a lot of these sports, like darts and snooker, have got in that is the personalities have been replaced by fucking machines.
Mm-hmm.
Machines in human form. Well, there's a lot of the young, like, Chinese and Thai players coming through who are exceptionally good at snooker, but they're nae crack, man. Do you know what I mean?
I know, like, you're right.
They're nae, because why would you be? And it's just, it's that ability to sell the game beyond the fact that you play snooker. Do you know what I mean? Like, Ronnie's the only guy that's been able to do that in the last 20 years. And if you take him out of it, man, you're no left with much.
It's the same idea of, you hear it in all these podcasts that I watch and listen to as well, you know, your Cy Ferries and your Open Goals. They're saying, you know, things like, even for their day, maybe 10 years ago, there's no, like, you know, social life in a football team anymore. The young guys don't go out to the pubs and get pished and get lifted. And, you know, there was a bit of camaraderie with that. Like, the snooker players, Ronnie, actually commented on it, you know, how they were all shit, really. And they were just, like, kind of a robot guys that are coming through and learning this. the basics of it and no really getting a character about themselves and trying stuff and fucking, you know, been doing a snooker club with the old guys in the corner slagging you for missing the black, and, you know, they've no experienced any of that. And I think a big element of that as well is that these guys are, you're in the press even when you're not famous because you're on social media. So see if you're doing anything out of the ordinary, some of the videos that you're up on social media and you're fucked. So they have to walk about with this fucking ironing board personality that nobody fucking, you know what I mean? There's no Liam Gallagher's, no Ronnie O'Sullivan's, no fucking, and that's what's happening. They, you know, all the people that we spoke about before, we, that are characters and make human beings, it makes the fucking thing. That's the whole thing about it. And picks, we're getting rid of it.
Picks on social media that are arguing about the fact, oh, there's no characters anymore, but the first ones to shop somebody in it, they're fucking fighting the boozer.
Fucking no joking, by the way. You're absolutely no joking. No, what that actually made me really think as well last night, seeing when we were I was watching the videos coming in for the group chats with the protest at Celtic Park. Every single video, and they were all going after heads at the fucking the fences, every single one of them had their phone up in there. Like videoing what they were doing, and I'm like, I mean, what the fuck? You're actually videoing your own riot. No. It's like it's beyond parody, some of that stuff, and it's wasted, really wasted a lot of it, you know, because these guys never feel safe. These young football players, young tennis players, young snooker players, they can't go to the pubs and just feel safe, right? The people in here, we can have a right good night and I'll maybe be off my head a wee bit. And, you know, and that builds character. You need to get through that when you're a young man. You need to do that. You need to get through that, and you need to be no fear to be getting put up on social media with a video of you up on the table having a dance. You know, and they're literally fear to stuff at that level now. If I'm spotted half cut, I'm going to be fucked. I'll lose my £1 million career. It's ahead of me, and that's all wrong.
See, when Gaza did his cruciate ligament in the FA Cup final 91, he was supposed to be signing for Lazio that summer for like fucking £5 million or something.
Mm-hmm.
He was on crutches for 6 months, and he finally got off the crutches, and within 2 weeks he learned to walk again. He went to a nightclub in Newcastle, got into a scrap with a boy. The boy kicked him in the fucking knee and knocked his kneecap out. Then he was out for another 6 months. The Lazio were waiting on him to turn up to train on the February, and he's like, oh, my knee's fucked again. And they still signed him and gave him all the money, and it's like, like, that's just, that's at the other end of the scale in terms of just being, like, unprofessional about your career. There's got to be a happy medium somewhere where we're no, like, it shouldn't be a big deal that Ryan Christie's just a bit greeting on the telly because he was put under so much pressure to win that fucking game for Scotland.
I know. What you should be doing is fucking greeting because he's going out to get absolutely fucking pushed and celebrate, and, you know, and that's what he's waited all his life today and get to the Euros and stuff like that. It's just, there's none of that anymore, and it becomes a bit cardboard. See, I'm going to slight one of my own players here, but see, Edward, he's the epitome of that. He just looks as if he's the guy that kind of had Disney sailing, Disney move rang, Disney get in the headlines. I know he was in the headlines when he was a wee bit younger and stuff like that, but they're just so scared. Their agents have got them programmed into thinking, you put one toe wrong and that's your whole career going out. And it is.
Sergio Aguero's lived in Manchester for fucking 10 years and he can speak about three lines of fucking English. He goes to training, he sends money back to his family, and he sits in the house and plays FIFA every fucking night.
Do you know, Kieran Tierney paid for one of his pals to go down and stay bottom, like a flat or something, just so he's got somebody down there that he's close to and stuff like that. So it's, they've got no fucking life, and I think they're actually told that, you know, when you become like 18 and you sign your pro or whatever contract, they're saying, see, for the next 10 years, all you're going to be doing is playing football and sitting in your house with your family, and then once that finishes, you can go and do whatever you want with all your money and stuff like that. But you're actually told for that 10 year, 15 year, whereas before it was just human beings in, you know, an elite part of sport, and the characters were all there, and it was, it's just all gone. It's all gone. And I think social media and the news and the media have all got a lot to answer for
so
that.
The days of the rock star fucking football player are finished,
man. And it doesn't need to be like Donnie's saying, you know, that there's the end of the scales, George Best and, you know, these Gazzas and all that, that I don't want to see young guys doing that. I really don't want to see them gone off the rails. I've seen a lot of good guys, you know, go really down a slippery slope with drinking drugs myself. I know even, you know, football players are sportsmen, but you've got to have the freedom at that age, for 17 to 25, I would say, that you can go out without any fear of, you can express yourself in any way that you want, as long as it's not hurting anybody and you're not hurting yourself. And you're not going to be slated on social media. You're not going to be the world's attention the next day. Whether that be just your wee circle world or the whole wide world, doesn't matter, because it's the same fucking feeling. So there's,
Caulfield, did you say that Lennon was coming into the tenants pub?
I'm not sure how much I should talk about this anymore on the podcast, but yes. Yes.
You got my sack.
All I'm saying for that point of view is, who gives a fuck if Neil Lennon is a pint? He's a fucking manager.
Ah, that's it, I know.
And he comes for that era, mate.
But he obviously feels as if he's unable to do that now because it will just make headlines because of who he is. And that's sad and insane. Mm-hmm. Like, I had a story, I listened to a podcast years ago. Again, like, Brian Clough, right, absolute genius, but again, probably on the wrong end of the scale in terms of what he did to himself and how often he was wrecked and stuff like that. But he took Forrest up to play Celtic in 1981. I think it was a UEFA Cup game, second round or something. And Davey Hay was the Celtic manager, and Clough phones up Davey on the day of the game, about 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And he's like, "Davey, let's go for a pint this afternoon, have a talk about your team and all that, and we'll have a talk about tactics and football and all that." And Davey's like, "Well," Davey Hay was a bit straight laced. He's like, "But fuck it," he's like, "I'll go and meet Brian Clough in it, so I'll go to the pub and meet him." He'd do it in the pub. The full fucking Nottingham Forest starting 11 for the game that night were sitting in the fucking boozer getting wrecked, and wouldn't beat Celtic 2-0 that fucking night.
Fucking love it, man. Love that shit. And that's, I mean, Lennon, you mentioned Lennon, he comes for that era of Martin O'Neill telling them, "You's going to have a pint together tonight."
Aye.
And see if somebody starts on him, make sure you're jumping in for him.
Exactly. But at the other end of the scale as well, though, you talk about 10 in a row for Celtic. Rangers didn't win 10 in a row because that team took it too far when it came to the bevy. Do you know what I mean?
Like, aye.
McCoy scoring and all that without fucking all the time.
And they were nuts.
Celtic didn't even get that many points that season under Janssen, but because that Rangers team were out in the fucking Randan every day.
I know. I think they were like, kind of like the Celtic team they knew. They were coming to their end as well, mate. It was like, you know, Advocate had kind of come in and tried to boost that up. And I think, see, I was speaking about this other day, and I hate fucking admitting it, but it's like anything in life, man. It's all cycles, isn't it? We stop there 9-10, they stop our 10, fuck it. You know, it's always going to be like, it's just like life, isn't it? Right. Not that I'm fucking admitting defeat yet, by the way. I'd just like to get that on the fucking record.
No, it's not over to the fat lady sings, I suppose.
But it's true, in a lot of ways, and a lot of people see it this way, that sport is just a complete waste of time. And I can kind of see, I like sport, but I can kind of see that.
And there's formulas in there.
I can understand that, you know. I don't know if you've seen that David Mitchell guy.
He's brilliant, man.
And they're talking about sport, and they're like, it's just a sketch show type thing. They're just like talking about goals, sport, and just making an arse of it basically. But it's quite funny, you know, just like one team will score more goals than the other, as if they're making like a Sky Sports.
I've seen that.
It's quite funny, but I can kind of see that as well. And people just say, you know, it is a bunch of guys kicking a ball about it. It is a bit. It's both things, you know. It's kind of ludicrous in a sense, but it's also,
I mean, that's the competition side of it, but I think there is like some underwritten universal formula that works with these things. There really is, and it just definitely seems to be, you know, the cycles happen, right? You do it with any game you watch, you go, I know that this is just going to happen here, and it always fucking does happen, do you know what I mean? You always go, well, they're going to come back and win 3-2 and end the day, you know, so there's definitely something like that involved in it that we don't know about.
Well, 100 years ago, there was a pandemic, same as
that. Exactly, mate, you know, cycles.
Years, it'll happen again.
That's it, so you'll get Labour next, and the government, and then the Tories next, and they're all shite as each fucking other.
I think with that is as well, like, sport has helped me to understand what day of the week is. Most days, to be perfectly honest.
Aye.
See, if there was no football, I know this is Monday because it's Champions League tomorrow.
Yep.
Do you know what I mean? That's my entire life is built around about knowing what day of the fucking week it is. And fair enough, I work in football and that, so it's quite important to know. But even if I didn't, that's how I would judge it. Like, what, the Masters is starting on Thursday, so that's tomorrow, right? So it's going to be 4 days of golf after that, and then we're back into Monday again and stuff. People need these routines in their life, and at the moment we're not got them because we're fucking, like, you wake up on a Sunday, it could be Wednesday, it could be Saturday, it could be anything, man. Like, it was my birthday 3 weeks ago the day, and I did absolutely fucking nothing. I usually play fives on a Monday night, couldn't even go out and play my fives, couldn't go out for a pint, couldn't go out with the missus for dinner, couldn't do anything. And every single day since that day has been exactly the fucking same. It's just like you need something to distract you, otherwise. Well, to be honest, I think the mental health ramifications of what's happened in the last 9 months haven't been truly felt yet. I think it's
I think you'll feel them more. I was watching a documentary about the Spanish flu, and there was a lot of people, like, in the aftermath, when everything kind of settled in, there was a lot of suicides and stuff like that because of just not being able to cope with everything getting back to normal and stuff like that, you know? It's
the funny thing is, mate, like, I was listening to John Ronson was on Louis Theroux's podcast about us, and I've suffered from anxiety, I've been on medication and that.
Is that past. John Ronson that wrote the Goats book, Staring at Goats and stuff? I've read all his stuff, he's amazing.
He's great, isn't he? But he suffers from anxiety and all, and he basically his anxiety is at his lowest point in years, like mine is. Because it's almost like we fucking felt you something bad was going to happen. Can I think?
Aye, aye. And
so you like, don't. Something bad has happened. It's almost like a verification of the fact we've been gaffer-heed for fucking nothing for years. Do you know what I mean? But now something has actually happened.
I think he was talking about as well the fact that he's a bit agoraphobic and like social situations is really awkward, and the fact that he's no got any of the pressures of, I know I need to go and do this speech at this thing tonight, you know, he's like, every day's the same, and that kind of that helps his anxiety, I suppose. And then when that, you know, they kind of people see when this, they switch the light back on and then it's everybody fucking running about like rabbits in the headlights again, a lot of the people will suffer really badly because they'll not be able to just go right back into it like that. So you're right, mate, there's going to be a massive thing like that, I think.
The funny thing is, just to extend on that, exactly what you're saying, mate, see any time that somebody contacts me and wants to write for me, right, and then I look through their Twitter feed, then it's usually young boys that think they fucking know everything about the world and all that, and they've got football worked out and all that. I always make a point of phoning them for 15 minutes to see what they're actually like, because obviously social media just fills you all the time about what you're looking at and you think, that guy's a cunt. But then you speak to him on the phone, you think, he's just a normal person. But the way that he acts on there, or the way that social media puts his content out, makes it look as if he's a cunt, but he's not really.
I think tone's a lot to be said for tone, isn't there? You know, see, if you're speaking to somebody or facing somebody, there's a lot to be said for body language and tone. And you're right, I mean, the amount of times I've been on social media and I've had somebody on my page that I don't really know, and I'm like, I wouldn't go on with that guy, and then I meet them in the pub and I'm like, this cunt's the best fucking mate I've ever had. Do you know what I mean? So it's that's probably the beer, but Ronnie O'Sullivan, Spanks, do you know who he is? Do you know who he is?
Aye, snooker player, same for me. I've taken a bit of a back seat. I think probably me and Neil, we've taken a bit of a back seat in this one because we're not really sporty guys, but it's been really interesting listening
I'm
to
really,
what you said.
I'm surprised to hear you're not into your sports. The build, the physique on you and the way that you carry yourself.
Oh, who, me?
Yeah.
Right, aye. I used to be a... I did play rugby.
Aye, rugby,
for a short
that's
spell.
Right, didn't you?
No, I did, aye. No, and I broke my collarbone.
You were a hooker, weren't you?
I broke my collarbone at training and I missed a piano exam, so that was me taking out the rugby.
The most middle-class things ever on the planet. A rugby game, then a piano lesson. Do you know what I mean?
Piano exam, actually.
You used to fucking throw in a game of croquet there, you Tory bastard. Neil, what about you, Ronnie O'Sullivan? Do you watch any snooker, mate, at all?
I used to watch quite a lot of snooker when I was younger. Yeah, I used to love it. Best days of Stephen Hendry and all that.
Yep.
But he was my man, Stephen Hendry. But Ronnie O'Sullivan, absolutely. Sent.
Henry's my man as well, mate, 100%.
A jumbo, man. Isn't he? He's a big jumbo, Henry, isn't he?
I don't know, I met him in the Timberland shop as well.
Did you? Stephen Henry?
Stephen Henry served him a pair of chinos.
Is that the same day as Usher?
Not the same day as Usher. It was a good few years before Usher.
You never told him any names for females?
No, I was right in the middle of like the Christmas rush when retail used to be extremely busy for like 2 or 3 months around about this time.
Is everybody in changing their fucking timber boots that they bought online?
He was buying chinos. He's buying weird chinos. Plain
chinos? Aye, is it? Beige chino-y guy, isn't he?
Yeah, he was buying beige chinos.
Beige? Were they beige right enough?
No, we're kind of greeny beige, I suppose.
He ditched his missus quite recently, Henry, for a wee bit on the side.
Did he?
Aye.
But a younger model?
I think she's like 21 or something. She's quite
what?
Young.
Fuck yeah.
Saint.
Maybe he's taking one out of Tiger Woods' book.
Aye. Merv Ronnie O'Sullivan.
Aye, same as well. 147 in 5 minutes is unbelievable. Playing both handed as well is unbelievable.
Aye, agree.
When it first came in.
That's true.
And that 147 that he wasn't going to put the black is just like the best thing he's ever done. Apart from putting the black. Just to be that good, you can like go and get a 147 and a 14 whatever, minus the black, and then decide you're not going to put it to make a statement is pretty cool.
You know what he's been doing during this? It's the UK Championship, was on in the tournament before it, just to wind up his opponent. He wasn't playing for snookers, he was just potting all the balls and losing the frame. Just because he wanted to keep the boy sitting in his arse for a bit, so he just was potting and getting beat. fucking nutcase, man.
If this was 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, in fact, I would have been like an absolute saint. The guy is a genius and everything that you've all reiterated, and he's the best that's ever played the game and all that. But I heard Higgins talking about his youth and when he was growing up and he was playing in the Masters and wishing with his dad and getting down to other wee bits. And Ronnie O'Sullivan, his childhood was like his mum and dad were very wealthy, comes from a very wealthy background, and he's got the snooker table in the house, and they were actually paying professionals to come to the house and train him how to play and all that. So a wee bit of me thinks he shouldn't be as arrogant as he is now with that, because, you know,
Ronnie O'Sullivan's dad was a fucking armed robber that did 15 years in the jail.
Well, that's where they get the money for then, is it not? So I didn't know that, but I heard Higgins talking about that, where they would pay for professionals to come and have a frame with them and stuff, and that's how he got.
Don't get me wrong, I love Higgins as well, just because obviously wishy boy and that, and
aye,
he's made the most of his abilities, man, 100%.
Aye, mm-hmm. And he's a good boy as well, know what aye. I mean? Anyway, Roger Federer, I will go first. I'm going to say banger because I know fuck all about tennis. Spanko.
I can remember what you tell me about him, Donnie, that he's basically the best sports person ever that there ever will be. And also, I also remember you telling me about the doping situation, because that the technology was that far behind that he's frozen his blood or something like that, just to prove that he's never ever doped.
So he's basically frozen blood samples that he took himself to prove that he's never been doping. Well, certainly know the day he gave a sample, he wasn't doping, so...
All right,
aye. But the cunt's 38 now or something, he's still gone, do you know what I mean? Like, most tennis players wrap it 31. Like, I think Murray might, because of his injuries, I think Murray might maybe get another year and he could be fucked. But Federer's still planning to come back and play next year, and fucking insane. Lively fitness. He does seem like a bit of a born bastard, in fairness, so, I mean, doesn't look as if he'd be a good scoop. Which is how I judge my fucking sports people these days.
Well, Andy Murray's got to be the worst for that. Yeah.
Did you see Celebration and fucking Marshall saved the penalty,
in,
man?
Get in.
Imagine him in the bedroom just before the heat of the moment. Know what I mean? Tearing plays off and Andy Murray's just standing there like, I'm really turned on.
Get in.
Neil. Roger.
I would say Saint. Aye. I think every time he's in Wimbledon or any tennis, I'm always rooting for him, regardless of who he's playing at the time. I was like, I hope he wins this one. Is he still unbeaten, or has he just been beaten? Is that right? He's.
Well, I don't know. You're asking the wrong guy here.
No, he's been beat before. Aye.
I don't mean beat. I just mean is his record. Is he still the one with the highest record?
I think he's the one with still with the most Grand Slams at the moment.
Aye,
I think. Aye. Although Nadal was catching him up a wee bit.
I just love he's got the most coolest head in tennis. He's just suave.
That seems to sweat, man. See all the other ones, they're all fucking sweat pissing off him.
No, he's just cool as a cucumber. Doesn't get angry. He's just like, cool, whatever. He wins and he's like, yes, so cool. That was good.
Isn't he sweat? Maybe he's just Prince Andrew playing tennis.
aye, Saint.
Mer, Roger Federer.
I would agree with everything that's been said. I think he is one of these guys that I don't know that much about tennis either, but I'm sure I've seen a stat, or I get the impression that people talk about guys with big serves and like this shot and that shot and these skills, but he seems to be just the guy that's got every single one of the attributes, you know? And it's because it's so effortless, he never really gets noticed, but I mean, unbelievable.
You had the nail on the head there, mate, I think. Like, he changed the game in a lot of ways. Like, before that, it was like Big Pistol Pete Sampras was just battering the fucking body at a million mile an hour, and even Ivanisevic and all these other cunts, whereas Federer had the ability to return these serves and change the game into a more, not to get fucking technical on it, but like a baseline game where there was exchanging shots rather than just smashing a serve and then volleying it in. It's a lot more exciting, and I think it's made the game of tennis a lot more interesting and get me a lot more people involved than it would be if it was just the same as it used to be in the old days.
I've seen some of his games, like, and you're right, see with that, most games that I watch, the serves are that hard, it's a lot of aces, so it's pretty boring, but his, he always seems to get them back, doesn't he, which is fucking staggering when they're coming at him like fucking 300 mile an hour.
I used to play tennis with a boy who was, like, he wasn't a fucking professional end, but he was a decent, like, kind of wee club player, and he used to smash the serve about 100 mile an hour, man, and the fucking ball would bounce back into play before I'd even fucking seen it. And they can hit them about fucking twice as hard as that.
That's like mate table tennis.
John Isner holds the ATP's official record for the fastest serve at 253 kilometres an hour. So it's 157 miles an hour.
You're a good server as well, though, aren't you, Spike?
Aye.
Of boots and pints.
Boots and pints.
Right, last one, lads. Zlatan Ibrahimovic will go with Donny.
Is a fitter player, he's a saint, is a man, he's a bit of a banger, to be honest.
He's a Marmite guy, isn't he?
The fact that he's still playing, scoring goals and all that at 39 after he got that serious injury last year, which should have effectively done him. Considering all the money he's got and all that and all the places he's played, I'd have been like, fuck this. But
I know, man.
He put so much effort into getting back and he's looking still pretty good, so there's a lot to be said for that. But he's a bit of a mercenary. He's managed by that Mino Raiola that's moved him from club to club to club and basically milked him.
Everything.
Milked all the clubs for everything they're worth over the years. And fair play, he's made some decent coin with it, but...
Aye.
This fucking... You can't be fucking having people refer to themselves in the third person, man. I think
I'm
saying.
I fucking can't...
Just bollocks that.
See, as well, he's built himself into a brand, and he's just a brand Zlatan now. He's like you say, the guy that's managing him is just milking everything that they can. I read a comment the other day about him where, I don't know if it's true or no because it wasn't social media, but somebody was asking him about signing for Chelsea, and he said, if I've won more trophies in Chelsea, I should be signing them. You know, that arrogance is quite good.
He had an autobiography about 10 years ago as well, which sold quite well. But and I read it and I quite enjoyed it, but it turns out that a lot of the stories that he tells in it about his various poverty and all that, and when he was younger, it was a bit far-fetched. It sounds as if he'd stretched the truth a lot in a lot of the cases. And
aye.
You know, like, don't fucking try and pretend you were fucking poor if you weren't, man. That's
rags
just,
to riches kind of thing. Aye, try to embellish that a wee bit.
They tell stories in it about, I used to come home and there was no food in the fridge and all that, and... I think he stretched the truth a wee bit there, and I don't really appreciate that. And also, in his book, he loves this fucking cunt Raiola that represents him, and he's a fucking wanker. He's the most obvious definition of a wanker you've ever seen in your entire life. And yet, he just seems to be happy. I mean, fair enough, if I had an agent that was getting me fucking the money that he's getting, I suppose I'd like him as well, but...
It's probably a bit perspective there, isn't it? I think as well, you know, it's when you're that big, you just become a bit bloated as well with yourself, like Ronnie has, I suppose, all these guys have. You reminded me there as well, it's like that X Factor sob story when they've been programmed to come out and tell you, they embellish the sob story just so that they can get through to the quarterfinals.
Aye.
Folk do that in their fucking autobiographies, man. I put it down, I'm like, get that to fuck, man. I hate that. Neil Zlatan.
I would say he's quite the character, but he should be like a baddie in a Quentin Tarantino movie.
Aye, Zorro.
I don't know him any more than that, so I have to say Saint.
Spanko, Zlatan.
I'll just say Saint, man. This is the one I'm kind of sitting out the night, because I've not got a fucking clue. I'll just say Saint, aye, good player.
You should be sitting out every week, mate.
I'm glad somebody's not.
Very good, very good.
Merv,
I don't have strong feelings either way. I'll probably go banger. I could be wrong, but I feel as if he's more of a brat. It's more style than substance. I could be wrong about that. I don't know. I mean, there's a lot of good strikers with the long career and played a lot of teams and scored a lot of goals.
That's a wee bit of that, mate. He's never won the Champions League. Do you know what I mean?
Aye. I've seen him in the flesh a few times, and see, any time I've seen him, I've not been that impressed. But I've seen him play amazing in the other games on the telly now. But any time I've seen him play in the flesh, I was like, he's not all that, you know.
I feel as if I've said this a lot, as if I'm dead in English recent in this podcast. But I'm sure I remember
it's
watching
a
World Cup
broadcast by the SNP.
And European Cups and that, and the English commentators were like, Zlatan, he's average, he's just average, he's never making the Premiership and that. And that seems to have changed, and everybody's
views
have
changed. Of course
he's
fucking waiting, mate, that's it. So it is, man. Like, see, just to take that a bit aside, this year, see, we want to look at English entitlement and English arrogance. Did you see the front pages they put out last week after Maradona died? Still talking about the fucking hand of God 35 years ago, man.
I'm fucking good at it.
I feel like I was just telling people I know. I'm like, this is why people hate you, by the way. Like, this is why everybody hates you.
That's actually their biggest. But that's bigger to them than winning the World Cup. That hand of God. Aye. That tells you everything you need to know about England and, you know, the English sort of psyche.
Aye, or we won the Falklands War, so therefore that means something to somebody. Aye. Like, fuck off, man.
I'm glad they scored that hand of God. I wish he'd have scored two hands of God. A hat trick, you know what I mean? Because it's like, and I suppose that the VAR thing and that, that's, you would lose that if that, well, we've lost that, but that was, that's the best goal. That's probably the best goal ever scored. And it wouldn't have been a good goal if it was against them deals, but because it was them, it's like...
See, when it happened, I didn't think it was a handball. See, when it actually happened, I didn't really see it as being a handball at the time. It was not until you seen the replay, I was like, fucking hell, that's a clear handball. See the way he done it? It was genius, kind of a move to heed as well at the same time as the hand went up. You know, when you just watch it in real time, it actually looks as if he gets his heed to it a wee bit. But obviously he didn't, because it was, you know, fucking clear as day after that, but aye.
But it's just this fucking, it's just this desire for a country that doesn't exist. That's all England does now to me, to anybody. And that, I mean, that, like, they'll probably kick me out tomorrow. I'll be up the road next week. But it's like fucking, like, you're, like, the fucking Crusades were about 500 years ago, boys. You know what I mean?
Like, that's the problem with the difference between nationalism between certain countries. I mean, Blind Boy talks about this, like, Scottish nationalism and Irish nationalism, it's not the same as English nationalism. Because it's, you know, it's based on colonization and nostalgia, which is completely different to, you know, what kind of Scottish nationalism.
If you want to understand how English people don't understand that, look at the story of the day about that. There was a street in London that was named after one of the colonists of India, and they've renamed it the street Guru Nanak, an Indian name. And just look at the comments underneath it. Why is this fucking street in our country getting renamed like this? Well, because you went and pillaged them for 250 years, mate. So maybe just changing a street name, maybe it's the least they can expect out of the fucking situation. Do you know what I mean?
No, absolutely, man.
And even like the Olympics and stuff we were talking about earlier, and just even this thing with these rules and regulations and these mad fucking different events and that. Should have heard somewhere, obviously, originally it was meant to be like ancient Greek or whatever. That's where it, or whatever, that's where it came from. But I think it was really the English British that made it into the modern day Olympics. And even when you think of the Commonwealth Games and that, it's a thing where it's like bringing in these countries that, you know,
Commonwealth Games, even the name,
it's fucking, I mean, it's, I know, fucking, it's like, that people compete in that, I think.
Come and play, I know, for me,
it's still I know. I mean, you think of what Britain went and done in, or what England went and done in their countries, and
that
then
said that,
sorry, but we're just we're common guys, we're Commonwealth, we're your pals, really, and come and play these this hurdles and that, and that's, you can win. If he's won that, then he's won, really.
We'll give you all your gold back if you win the hurdles, the 200 metre hurdles, we'll give you all your gold back and that. Aye.
That's what the Hunger Games.
That's exactly what it is, mate, to be honest.
There's a bit in Billy Connolly's documentary that Billy Connolly did, that Who Do You Think You Are he was on, and they traced it back to one of his relatives was fucking,
I think I seen that.
It was like 130 years ago or something. It was living in one of the big cities at the time. I don't know where it was. Well, that was the other thing. We fucking renamed India cities. Didn't fancy the names yet, so we're calling this place Delhi now, boys. Is that alright? Fucking deal with it. Do you know what I mean? Like, what the fuck is that?
Being a complete sidetrack, but you've just mentioned made me think of something. I went down a YouTube rabbit hole. Did you know that there was 20 million people lived in the Amazon forest? Did you know that? There used to be cities and all that in the Amazon forest. And there was like this, a Spanish explorer guy who went down, he travelled, he was the first guy to go from east to west, right across down the river. And he came back and he reported and seen all these cities and all these millions of people and inhabitants. And then 100 years later, they went down and they didn't find any. And the guy must have been talking absolute shite. But they're using a technology called LIDAR. I don't know if any of you have heard of this. And it basically can look between dense forests. They can pick out and they're finding all these cities in the Amazon that get wiped out because when the Spanish came, they obviously rifed them all with smallpox and they all disappeared. And they're actually just finding out now through, if you type in LIDAR, LIDAR, just like radar, but LIDAR, it's all our YouTube. It was actually on a Joe Rogan podcast that I was listening to the other day as well. It's fucking incredible, man. They actually had irrigation systems and everything back in the, you know, 1400s, and 20 odd million people they think lived in here, and now it's just complete and utter rainforest. Mental, that, innit?
That's big up my street, mate. I'm going to check that out.
Check it out, man. Check it out. I was fucking right down a rabbit hole, mate. You need to watch yourself.
Well, we're doing recommendations. You need to watch now that BBC's 4 series, like Storyville. It tells like documentary stories. They just did one on DB Cooper.
Somebody was talking about us.
He's the only guy ever to get away with hijacking a plane on American soil.
I need to watch this.
It's fucking. I'm not wasting it for these, because if I tell you any of the details, it'll just ruin some of the surprises. But the fucking story is absolutely out of this world, man. It's about an hour and a half long, so you'll need to fucking sit down and watch it. But it's just. You literally couldn't sit down and make it up. It's fucking incredible.
Donnie, I love that shit, man. I'll begin down the stairs and kicking that celebrity shite off my telly and watching that directly, mate. That's a great recommendation. I heard somebody else posting about that the other day. I was like, I need to check that out.
See, when you're done with that one, there's another story villain there about Jim Jones and the cult, Brian Jones, the Jonestown cult.
I've seen that.
I've never seen anything like that. My puff, man.
Horrific, mate, innit?
Mental stuff, man.
Is that? I'm right in saying that's the one where they've got the footage of the bodies and all that. It's fucking horrific, man.
They dug up some unbelievable footage and they've got all the survivors and all that talking about what happened on the days and all that. It's fucking insane.
It was Kool-Aid, wasn't it? They just fucking put out in the Kool-Aid and everybody drank it. And some people were forced to drink it. But just to make you go into one that's quite like that, I think it's on Netflix or it could be on Sky Documentaries. And it's about a guy that's, I need to get the name out for you, mate, but I'll send it on to you. But it's the cult, same thing about the cult, but it's actually a self-help cult in America that has started, how you become a better person. You actually just become a slave to these fuckers, man.
I saw it pop up on Netflix. Aye, what's the name?
I'll find out. I can't mind. I think it's Sky Document. The Vow.
I saw it again, is it?
Something like The Vow, I think it's called, but it's fucking incredible, man. But I digress. Anyway, thanks very much, Donnie. That was amazing, mate.
That was brilliant, mate. Thank you very much.
Cheers.
You're very welcome, man. Thanks very much for listening, folks, as well. Thank you. Thanks very much for listening to the Carbon Copy COVID Curer podcast. We'll be back soon with another ill-informed, chat-filled episode. Why not tell us what you think by email? Inquiry at carboncopymusic.band or visit our website, carboncopymusic.band. And if you're feeling really generous and you haven't already, please give us a like on our Facebook, facebook.com/carboncopy4, and even our Instagram, @carboncopyweddingband. Thanks again. No bangers were harmed during the makeup of this podcast. Carbon Copy will serve you right more than anything they like, and they will. Thank you.